He refused to go to school. He spent his downtime playing with dead bodies, and when he wrote backwards. Who was this dyslexic, ghoulish, dropout miscreant? Only one of the greatest minds in the history of humankind, and we're giving him some lip service, not that he needs it, today on Book of the Day. Welcome to Book of the Day for November 7th, 2022. It's a Monday. We're going to have a wild week here again. I'm very excited, and of course, I'm doubly excited to welcome back to the fold our book critic at large, Steve Donahue. Steve, good day to you.
Hello, everybody.
So nice to see you again.
I had to worry about your teaser intro. There's always some sort of passive-aggressive maneuver going on in your teaser intro where I'm starting to think all these complimentary things are about me or the creepy things are about me. But no, neither one was. We're talking about someone else today.
A big figure.
Yes. Large. A big biography.
Walter Isaacson.
Da Vinci by Walter Isaacson.
Absolutely.
His big biography of Leonardo, the kind of the follow-up to his surprise hit and surprise mega bestseller biography of Steve Jobs.
Right.
He has a self-professed in interviews penchant for biographies of geniuses. And whenever that line is spoken on national TV, probably 3 dozen people who were screwed over by Steve Jobs start screaming at them. In his defense about that earlier book, which we'll get to on Book of the Day.
Certainly.
Isaacson isn't saying that Jobs was a technical genius. Mm-hmm. He's saying that he was a genius at, he uses entrepreneurship. You could also say he's stealing other people's ideas and making them work. But with Leonardo da Vinci, we have the real thing. We don't need to worry about categorizing geniuses here.
I don't think the word entrepreneur was even a thing when da Vinci was doing his thing.
And he would have failed at it.
Yeah.
As every, you know, you can be great, see you at the top of the mountain, entrepreneurial book in existence ever says, the number one thing you need to succeed is grind. What the 21st century refers to as grind. And Leonardo did not have that. It was one of the only qualities he didn't have. He abandoned more projects than most of his fellow artists in the Renaissance abandoned children.
He wasn't driven.
Not always when resources ran dry either, or a patron changed his mind. Often he abandoned them because he was bored.
Yeah. Done with painting. Time to the next thing.
But Isaacson makes a really good point in this book, which is that... this is a figure that a lot of people think they know without having read any biographies of him. There was a really brainy biography of him by Charles Nickel, mm-hmm. did a book that's behind me on the death of Christopher Marlowe. There's a fantastic, sumptuous one-volume biography by Sergei Bramley that is incredible. The British art poobah, Kenneth Clark, did a slim book on Leonardo da Vinci that is 10 times more eloquent mm-hmm. than any book in English on Leonardo that's ever been done.
Sure, absolutely. So
there's no shortage of biographies, but if you don't read them, you're going to think you know who this is.
Absolutely. Well, and Isaacson does something that I suspect those other books you mentioned may not have done. It's so conversational.
Yes. Yes. He is very much, I mean, it's no longer true that he is an everyman narrator. He's not an everyman narrator. He's vastly learned. But nevertheless, he manages to bring that out in his prose and show you, the reader, things that you might not have seen without him. But unlike, for instance, Kenneth Clark, he doesn't try to make you seem stupid if you miss them, if you miss those little details. In fact, I have an example of that.
Please.
If you don't mind. Mm-hmm. Dealing with Leonardo's most famous piece of artwork, the Mona Lisa. We have, Isaacson goes on at great length in this book on all of Da Vinci's artwork, and that's really good. Mm-hmm. Some Da Vinci biographers feel less confident to do that. But when he's talking about the Mona Lisa, he calls her Lisa. I don't know why. I'm not gonna change it, so we're gonna do this.
Keeping it conversational, again.
yes.
It's my buddy.
Expecting Mr. Giaconda to come to the door and say, hey, you... That's my wife.
Anyway, fiery bunch that they are.
Covering Lisa's hair is a gossamer veil worn as a mark of virtue, not mourning. which is so transparent that it would be almost unnoticeable were it not for the line it makes across the top of her forehead. How many people looking at the Mona Lisa never noticed that line or knew what it was when they did notice it? Look carefully at how it drapes loosely over her hair near her right ear. It is evident that Leonardo was meticulous enough to paint the background landscape first and then used almost transparent glazes to paint the veil over it. Also, look at where her hair comes out from under her veil at her right forehead. Although the veil is almost transparent, the hair underneath is painted to look a tiny bit gauzier and lighter than the hair flowing from underneath it and covering her right ear. When the unveiled hair cascades over her chest on both sides, Leonardo is back to creating the swirling curls he adored. I don't know how many people without benefit of, you know, an art instruction or the, sure, one of those audio guides at a museum would notice those things. And that's all through this book.
Amazing. Yeah, that's great. I mean, you'd have to, most people, when you glance, and most people just glance at the Mona Lisa, but once you start taking it millimeter by millimeter by millimeter, those are the things that I think stand out, and Isaacson captures that beautifully, certainly.
Although Isaacson doesn't mention it, I firmly believe that once you've studied the Mona Lisa long enough, you realize that she was a lizard person. Clues are all there. then you, suddenly the audience hears a Cederberg edit line. I'm sorry, folks. clues are all there.
I did not think we'd be going to X-Files territory during this episode, but that's fine.
one other thing about this book that you're not going to notice until you hold it in your hand is how heavy it is.
It's a beast.
And the reason that it's heavy is not because it's a particularly long book, but because it's the paper stock. And yes, the reason for that is because it's full of artwork.
Yes.
Unlike most other Leonardo books that have, you know, an inset of color photos, or in Kenneth Clark's book, an inset of black and white photos.
Sure.
7 pages in the middle. This is full of artwork. Not only everything that Leonardo ever did, every sketch that's in his sketchbooks, every finished work, but also all of the contemporary art all around him.
Right, right.
Must have been mind-boggling and expensive to produce.
Absolutely, glad that absolutely.
Because it did sell well. But
indeed.
Incredibly expensive to produce, to get all that artwork on every page.
For a library, most amusingly, that is a book that we have had to repair more often than not, which is interesting. And it was popular. It really, you know, to see that book on our new arrivals wall, circulating as it did, and having to repair it as often as we did, and replace it as often as we have, that's kind of cool, actually. I was very excited and heartened by that.
Those readers weren't just flipping the pages for artwork. The key here is two things. One is what you mentioned, that Isaacson strikes a tone that very much includes the reader and yes, highlights how many learned biographers strike a tone that excludes readers. You really realize that when you read a biographer like this.
Yeah.
Or like, for instance, the late David McCullough.
Certainly.
That when you read someone like that, you realize the difference between a tone that invites you in, presumes your intelligence, but your lack of experience, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, and a tone that says, why don't you just sit quietly while I lecture to you? Right, right. That's one element. And the other element is that Da Vinci's life was fascinating.
Yeah.
Absolutely certainly fascinating. Some of the things that he did are mind-boggling even now. Some of the ways that he saw the future are mind-boggling even now.
I mean, if I start playing with cadavers at lunch today, they're going to talk here in town, I tell you. It's going to come up. It's fine.
I hope you're not referring to Book of the Day. I am, after all, only 28.
Every day at 11 o'clock.
Yeah, playing with cadavers.
Punch my clock. Absolutely. But for good reason. It's not like the guy was a ghoul. He just, obviously, the artistry and the, you know, understanding the human form. I mean, that is something that no one had really, you know, so exhaustively done, it seemed.
The thing that you're taking for granted when you take a basic anatomy course is that stuff wasn't known. It was known in animals,
right,
in farm animals, but it wasn't known in humans to anything like the degree that Da Vinci wanted to know it. And the only way that he could really do that was to dissect a corpse.
Yeah.
And there were a bracket of religious restrictions about that in his own day and for centuries afterwards.
No, sure.
So there were obstacles, not just in terms of the limit of his imagination, but in terms of what he could do. No wonder that he spent so much time in the realm of hypothetical.
Sure, sure. But flying machines, war machines, remarkable.
War machines, all kinds of bicycle machines.
Yeah.
He was a big fan of self-contained units in virtually everything that he did. And it's not a thread that Isaacson really brings out, but you can't avoid it. When he thought up some technical system, he wanted it to work on its own, apart from anything else. And when he made a great work of art, like, for instance, the Mona Lisa, he was notoriously reluctant to give it up. He traveled around with the Mona Lisa rather than surrender it to the person who paid for it. And that also reflects his own itinerant status. He didn't want to be tied down to any one patron. He
Absolutely.
Took long-term patrons, but there's an urge for self-contained. And the seamless segue is that this book does that. This book is a self-contained, wonderful little world.
He would have hated it.
or Book of the Day.
Without a doubt.
To start the week. Like I mentioned, there are other really good Leonardo da Vinci biographies, but for once, happily, the one with the broadest circulation that is the newest is also really, really good.
Without a doubt. Absolutely. You know what's nice about that one, too?
This is represented in the library system?
Oh, very much so. Oh, no problem at all. Outside of the fact that, again, all of them in various states of disrepair and spines that are making weird noises. So what's nice about that book, too, is that, and it's one of my favorite kinds of books, and it's maybe even one you want to consider owning for the sole reason that you can jump in anywhere in the middle and you're immediately enraptured by something. He almost takes a Patterson-esque approach to his chapter layouts. They're very short chapters. And so that seems to be America's favorite way of reading nowadays. So those short chapters, and fine. I mean, it seems to work. So,
Isaacson does a great job of so to speak, sealing off those shorter chapters too. So I don't recommend that you jump in on chapter 30, but if you did, you really would be able to read chapter 30 almost as an essay on its own.
Certainly, certainly. Yeah.
It's interesting.
One of those fun books you can keep in any room of the house, and then whatever housework you are going to do won't get done.
My producer is correct, however. This is a book from Book of the Day that you are going to want to own. I know that's verboten on a library show, but nevertheless, you're going to want to find a copy of this and own it. It's that pretty.
It is. It really is. It's I have one myself. Someone turned one in used for our used bookstore. Buy the book. Plug for our friends of the Cedarburg Public Library. Big book sale coming up, Steve. We'll have to talk about that. But we even say that. Look at the look. Look at the... I feel like a Bugs Bunny cartoon where I just turn into a can of ham. It's going to devour me whole. One of our shows this week will be officially brought to you by Book of the Day and the Friends of the Cedarburg Library's book sale starting Sunday. This Sunday. Actually, Monday officially, but they'll be setting up on Sunday. So we'll talk about that as time goes on. And I'll probably be making a care package to Steve at some point. So there we are. Book of the Day back on the air for the week, and wonderful choice for today's book. And I would have to say two words to you, and that, of course, is thank you.
It's my pleasure. I could talk about Leonardo until the cows come home, but this is a very good. We're starting off the week with a strong recommendation.
Absolutely.
As partial acknowledgement of the fact that some of the books we read last week, I couldn't really recommend. So, we can do a little bit better in that regard.
I've seen the list. I'm going to be here. We'll see you all tomorrow. Thank you, everybody.